HarperCollins and Harper Audio present Taking Care, The Story of Nursing and Its Power to Change Our World by Sarah DiGregorio. Read by Anne-Marie Gideon. For a mole, and for all who nurse. Author's note. I put a lot of thought into how to identify people's professional roles in this book. I would like to be succinct, clear, and respectful. In the end, I decided that the best solution was the one that would provide the most clarity for the reader with the most simplicity. So, where applicable, I have identified people upon first mention by whichever degree, PhD, MD, BSN, ADN, and license, RN, APRN, CNA, most clearly identify them within the context of this book. Some sources have many more than two credentials, which they customarily list after their names. For those sources, I have chosen, in concert with that source, to list the degree and license best able to help the reader understand that source's role. For instance, I identify a nurse scholar who usually includes PhD, RN, FAAN after her name as a PhD, RN, and then make it clear where that person works and in what context. Also, in all cases, I have omitted honorifics, including doctor, because it is not clarifying. A doctor holds a doctorate. That could be a PhD, an MD, a DDS, and so on. This is also why I refer to physicians as physicians and not doctors. By contrast, a degree and license clearly identify a person's practice, discipline, and education. For the purposes of this book, I define nurses and nursing as broadly as possible, in part because nursing has historically been defined narrowly in a purposefully exclusionary way with regard to race, class, gender, and cultural context. When considering practitioners over time, deciding whom to call a nurse is often subjective, as healthcare practices and professions have not always been defined, licensed, or delineated the way they are today. When looking to the past, I cast a wide net, including all caregivers who arguably practiced with a recognizable and distinct nursing ethos. There are plenty of holes to be poked in this approach, but I believe that a narrower focus has only impoverished our understanding of the vast potential of nursing, and served both to keep people out and to discredit different ways of knowing. This has limited the care available to everyone. Conceptualizing the field in the most expansive, inclusive ways can invite many more people into the project of nursing, help the public value nursing differently, and help nurses build new meanings from their work. There is, of course, often a difference to be drawn between nurses who are trained and accredited and all those who nurse. However, training and accrediting are not and have never been neutral or available to all. When some say, for instance, that Florence Nightingale was a nurse, but that her contemporary Mary Seacole, a Jamaican woman who nursed, was not, or when we call trained male nurses of the past physician assistants or orderlies instead of nurses, we are perpetuating the false idea that nurses are one kind of person with one kind of knowing. To find the stories in this book, I used primary sources like newspapers and autobiographies, but I also relied very much on the deep and scholarly research of nursing historians, who do the hard work of excavating and analyzing nursing history. If you are interested in nursing history, this book is a great place to start, but please note that the many historians who are quoted and cited here go deeper in their own writings than this space allows. See the extensive notes on my sources and the selected bibliography. Quotes from the interviews I conducted have been condensed and lightly edited for clarity. In some cases, such as when a source was not authorized to speak to the press, was concerned about retaliation, or for patient privacy, interviewees are identified by their first name only, or by a pseudonym where noted. Introduction. If you have spent any time in a hospital or healthcare setting, you've probably had an encounter with a nurse that lingers in your mind. For most of my life, I have accompanied my mother, my father, and my daughter, all of whom suffered serious chronic illnesses, to hospitals, clinics, and rehab centers, and through therapy of all kinds. To need healthcare in the United States is to seek healing in what often seems to be an inhuman labyrinth. But every now and then, someone in that labyrinth manages to see you, hear you, and offer exactly what you need. For me, these encounters stand out with crystalline clarity. They were moments of relief. Someone was going to help us. Someone could help us. Even when that help didn't include a cure, even when there wasn't a fix. And almost every single time, the person who offered what we needed was a nurse. I've come to understand that that was not a coincidence. Sooner or later, we all need to be nursed. A nurse may have been at your birth and may be at your death. Sometimes nurses are the first and last people to touch us. Nursing is a profession, an independent scientific discipline, a practice, and a way of interacting with the world. It's also an elemental public role, one that elicits deep feelings, beliefs, and anxieties in the collective imagination. I came to this meditation on nursing as a journalist, but also as someone who grew up surrounded by the illnesses of the people I loved most. Because I'm not a nurse myself, my perspective has limitations. But I would argue that nursing matters to everyone. It draws much of its power and effectiveness from the relationship between nurse and patient. It is the indispensable foundation of all healthcare. And so, in that sense, nursing belongs to everyone. When I was lost in the wilds of the American healthcare system, nurses showed me and my family how to move forward. Nurses are not just there at the most profound moments in people's lives. They use their knowledge and skills to guide people through those moments. There was the nurse who held me by the shoulders after I ran out of my mother's hospital room, terrified. That nurse explained that the ragged, irregular gasps coming from my mother were a normal part of dying. I was 21 years old, alone, confused, and frightened. But that nurse told me what was happening and what to expect. She said I could stay and hold my mother's hand while the gasps got farther and farther apart and then finally stopped. She gave me and my mother the gift of being together at that moment. There was the nurse who kept her hand on my leg when 2 decades after my mother died of breast cancer, I had a suspicious mass in my own breast biopsied. While the pathologist examined the extracted cells, this nurse kept up a gentle patter, telling me about her family, how she and her 2 sisters had grown up in a tiny 1-bedroom apartment in Manhattan, how they still liked to be physically close to one another. When the physician poked his head into the room to report that the mass was benign, the nurse put both her hands on my back and told me to feel what I needed to feel. I cried with relief. There was the nurse with long braids who let me hug her while I got an epidural before an emergency C-section. Afterward, there was the nurse who got down next to my wheelchair and showed me how to hand express breast milk. She literally milked me so I could bring colostrum to my prematurely newborn daughter, Mira, who was 2 floors below in the neonatal intensive care unit, NICU. There was the NICU nurse who stood quietly and looked at Mira in her incubator for many minutes at a time. She wasn't focusing on Mira's test results or her vital signs on the monitor above. Watchful and silent, she took the time to observe minor changes in my daughter's skin tone, her arm and leg movements, just the way she seemed that day. It was this nurse who helped me to see my daughter underneath all the technology keeping her alive. Then, there was the visiting nurse who came to our apartment to weigh Mira every day for 2 weeks after she was finally discharged into a cold, anxious February. That nurse assured me that by the time summer came, we'd be hanging out in the park with a healthy baby. She'd seen it so many times before, she said with confidence. She seemed so certain, so not shocked by my tiny baby, that she yanked me out of my own shock. And she was right. Mira improved. Summer came. The winter Mira was 4 years old, she struggled with asthma flare-ups. She would come into our bedroom in the dead of night, gasping and wheezing, unable to speak. Before either of us was fully conscious, my husband or I would grab the rescue inhaler, press the mask to her face, and count her respiratory rate. After a few months of this, her pulmonologist decided that Mira needed a bronchoscopy, a scoped examination of her bronchial tubes and lungs, to try to figure out why the standard controller treatments weren't working. My husband and I sat in the waiting room as the procedure was done under general anesthesia. It was supposed to be routine outpatient surgery, but it was taking too long. By the time they said we could come back to the recovery area, I knew something was wrong. The attending pulmonologist rushed at me. He was on his way somewhere else. He was in a hurry. He said, "Severe uncontrolled asthma, lots of mucus and swelling, bronchial tubes 30% smaller than expected, airway very reactive to the procedure." And then he was gone. Mira was still unconscious with an oxygen mask over her face, too pale, so tiny in the hospital bed. On the monitor, her oxygen saturations were in the low to mid 80s, too low. There were several busy clinicians in the room, including a respiratory therapist who put Mira on a CPAP, continuous positive airway pressure machine. "We need to get her saturations up," someone said. "Are you going to intubate her?" I asked the room. I heard my voice rise high with panic. "That's one possibility," someone said. Mira's small chest heaved, but her face was slack. Fear clamped my throat. And then, a nurse who was standing by the bed with one hand resting lightly atop Mira's head looked me right in the face. Within the hubbub of the room, she remained still and held eye contact. With authority, she said, "It's okay, Mom, it's okay. It looks worse than it is. We're going to get her saturations up." Throughout the next hours, that nurse never failed to look me in the eye. She never failed to talk about my daughter as my daughter, not as a set of defective bronchial tubes that could maybe be fixed and maybe not. She gently pounded Mira's back to dislodge the mucus blocking her airway. She told us exactly what she was doing and showed us how to do it ourselves. And as she tended to Mira, she made gentle, practiced small talk that took my mind off the situation. And she was right. It did look worse than it was. Mira's saturation level came up. She was admitted, but not intubated, and she recovered. Probably a dozen clinicians laid hands on Mira that day, but I remember, I will always remember, that nurse. In February 2020, I was doing a bookstore event for my first book, Early, on the science and culture of premature birth, work inspired by Mira's early arrival. During a Q&A, one man told me his twins had been born quite prematurely, and then he said, "I just want you to talk about the NICU nurses. The NICU nurses meant so much to us." And then he started to cry. I didn't know what to say because, frankly, thinking about the NICU nurses who cared for my daughter usually rendered me mute. I couldn't piece together an intelligent thought, but I remember saying something like, "I loved them," and leaving it there. I had lived my way into a deep appreciation for nursing work. I knew that if you wanted something done, you had better ask a nurse, nicely. But I had not yet taken the time to consider their role more deeply. When I reflect more deliberately on the nurse who took care of Mira after her bronchoscopy, it becomes obvious how skilled and complex her practice was. At all times, she was working within several facets of nursing. She was handling the acute care Mira needed, watching her vital signs, adjusting the respiratory support accordingly, and consulting with the respiratory therapist. She was communicating with the rest of the healthcare team. When she explained how to dislodge the mucus blocking Mira's airways, an intervention known as chest PT, she was providing Mira with needed care and educating my husband and me at the same time. And by calming me, I'm sure it was obvious I needed calming, she was not simply being kind or humane, but was using an intervention that was also to Mira's benefit. Research has shown that hospitalized kids may have better outcomes when their parents experience less anxiety. By expressing both her skill and authority within the clinical situation and her compassion for me as a mother, that nurse built a trusting relationship with me in a matter of minutes. She made it comfortable for me to talk to her and that was also a part of her expertise. There's an oft-quoted observation that people may forget what you did, but they will never forget how you made them feel. This was true for me back then. What I remember most about that nurse is how she made me feel. But when we non-nurses focus on how nurses make us feel, we sometimes fail to recognize their knowledge, or we implicitly devalue their professionalism.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.